gospel about his journey. From heaven to earth. For humanity, his journey. From the cross to you. Not the God the world wanted, the God the world needed. The journey of the gospel of Luke.
Guys, I want to welcome you today to Southside Church. Thank you so much for joining us and being a part of a church that desires to build real followers of Jesus Christ. And we want to make it real easy to go to heaven from right here in Northeast Georgia. And from my heart to you, I just want to say welcome home. And thank you for being a part of this day with us as we continue our journey through the Gospel of Luke. And what we learned last week as we opened the door in the Gospel of Luke is that Luke is a doctor. And Luke is writing a detailed and accurate account of the life of Jesus to his friend Theophilus. And it's a message that he was writing to an individual. And I think that's so cool because Jesus' life and his ministry and his message was to individuals. It's a message that he spoke to groups, large crowds, and all kinds of different people. But it's a message that's meant specifically for you. And we see that today. And so Luke wrote his gospel so that we might have an accurate and orderly narrative of the journey of Jesus, his life, his ministry, and his message. Simply put, Luke is a book with a message for everybody. Everybody and anybody. You can find a story, you can find an encounter, you can find a message from Jesus that impacts you where you are today. And so I called this message Interruptions and Invitations. Why that? Because of this. Some of life's greatest invitations actually look like interruptions. And we see that in three different stories today in Luke chapter 5. And what we see today is that Jesus makes the difference in your life and in mine. And so Jesus, simply put, is the difference. And we begin by seeing how Jesus can make the difference in our life from failure to success. From failure to success. And so Jesus is the difference in that area. He's found right here somewhere in the middle of that. And we see that in a story that begins in Luke chapter 5 today, and it starts like this. As the crowd was pressing in on Jesus to hear God's word, he was standing by Lake Gennesaret. All that is context. It just shows you where he is. When you read the Bible, you got to read your Bible and look at it in where it was, the context of where the passage happened, where Jesus is teaching, what is going on in that culture. And then it's important for us in this world to build a bridge into our day and time and apply those teachings to our daily lives. And so maybe, probably, possibly, every one of us listening today or watching today has had a moment of failure in our life. And I want you to understand, failure is not final. It doesn't have to be. Failure is not final. It's just an opportunity for you to learn, grow, and succeed and keep moving forward. And so as the crowd was pressing in on Jesus to hear God's word, he was standing by the lake. And he saw two boats at the edge of the lake, and the fishermen had left them, and they were washing their nets. And he got into one of the boats, which belonged to a man named Simon, who you'll later learn to know is Peter. And so Simon was the owner of this boat, along with his brother Andrew, and Jesus asked him to put out a little from the land. And then he sat down and was teaching the crowds from the boat. In those days, if a teacher was teaching, he sat down and the crowd stood up. And so Jesus sat down and began to teach them from just off of the shore as the large crowd had gathered to hear his teaching. And when he had finished speaking, I mean, I know some people want to know, well, what did he say? Well, that's not important in the story today. What's important is really the invitation that comes from this story that really looks more like an interruption. When he had finished speaking, Jesus said to Simon, "Put out into deep water and let down your nets for a catch." That's interesting because Simon responds with this, "Master, we've worked hard all night long and caught nothing." Now, Peter, or Simon here, and his brother Andrew are professional fishermen. Translation, they do this for a living. And in first century Israel and Jerusalem, and this time, if you were a professional fisherman in this region, you fished at night. And you didn't fish in deep water, you fished in shallow water. And you used nets, and you would throw them over, and the fish would get in, you would pull them in. And I'm sure there were nights like these where Simon and Andrew were unsuccessful, where they didn't have a lot of fish, or maybe they didn't have any fish. On this particular night, they didn't catch anything. And so when they fished at night, they fished in shallow water. When it was daylight, they would bring them in, and they would wash their nets. They would go home and sleep, and they would get ready for the next night to keep doing it again. Well, here, Jesus says, don't just put out a little bit in shallow water. Put out in deep water. It's in the daytime. And throw your nets across the side. And Peter's like, why? We've worked hard all night and caught nothing. But this is significant. This is what he says. But at your word, I'll let down the nets. In some ways, I picture Peter like, great. This is, you know, you're just slowing me down. It's really an interruption. I've already cleaned my nets. I'm tired. I'm hungry. I'm ready to go to bed. But because you ask, I'm going to do it. And when they did, they caught a great number of fish, and it was so large that their boat began to sink. I can't imagine, you know, it's just frustration. It's an interruption. Peter, Simon, and Andrew go. They toss their net over, and immediately the fish just jump in it to the point where the boat goes whoop. And they begin to pull it in, and their nets are tearing because there's so many fish. And they signal to their partners in the other boat, man by the name of Zebedee with his two young sons, James and John, who are learning the family trade. And he says, hey, this their business partners, come and help them. And they came and filled their boats so full that their boats began to sink. And when Simon Peter saw this, he simply fell at Jesus' knees and he said, go away from me because I'm a sinful man, Lord. Isn't it ironic that when we encounter moments like this, And moments of frustration or moments of interruption, and they sometimes, you know, they just kind of fuel bitterness in our life and cause us to be frustrated. But when something good comes out of it, and it turns us on a dime, and a lot of times we feel guilty. We feel guilty about ourselves and our actions and our decisions, our words that we said. Well, Peter's no different. And he fell on his knees and fell on his face before God, and he said, go away from me, I am a sinful man. For he and all those with him were amazed at the catch of fish that they took. And so were James and John, Zebedee's sons, who were Simon's partners. Don't be afraid, Jesus said to him, because from now on, you're going to be catching people. Then they brought the boats to land, they left everything, and they followed him. What do you see here? You see an interruption that became an invitation. And Jesus took a night of failure and turned it into a day of success. And what can we learn from this passage today? We simply learn this, that Jesus' power can unleash the faith in your life to follow him. The power of Jesus has the potential to unleash faith in your life to simply follow him. Because that's what these men did. These men were fishermen by trade. That was their profession. And when it says they left everything and they followed him, it means they left everything. They left it behind and said, we would rather follow you based on the experience that we've just had because we have faith in you and we're going to follow you. So Jesus' power simply unleashes the faith to follow him because Jesus is the difference. Jesus is the difference from success or from failure to success. In part number two today in Luke 5, we see that Jesus is the difference from sickness to health. From sickness to health. This is what happens. He moves on, and now he's traveling with people, with Simon and Andrew and James and John. And while he was in one of those towns, a man was there who had a serious skin disease all over him. He had leprosy. And he says when he saw Jesus, he came to him, fell face down, and begged him, "Lord, if you are willing, you can make me clean." Leprosy was a disease in those days that would basically cut off circulation to the extremities of your body to where you couldn't feel them. And it was an infection that would defile a person outwardly. And when you had this defilement, this infection, and it became visible, the world or the community would label you as unclean and they would quarantine you. You had to socially distance, to use a very relevant term in 2020, and you could not come around people because you were unclean. To the point where when you would walk through the town, if you came in around people, people would literally yell out, "Unclean, unclean, unclean." So it's very humiliating. And it was an isolating disease that would keep people from going out in public. And it was a disease that would ultimately kill people. And like leprosy, sin is the same way. But leprosy is a public, it has public infection or public spots, and our sin is more private. So where leprosy may be something people can see on the outside, sin is something that defiles us on the inside. And so we have the same issue. It's just our sickness is more internal, where this sickness was external. And so this man broke all kinds of rules to get to Jesus. All right. It was actually against the law that could cost this man his life for this man to do exactly what he did right here. This was not just against culture. This was against the law for this man with this disease to come to Jesus, fall face down at his feet and beg him, "Lord, if you are willing, you can make me clean." You see, Jesus is the difference from our sickness to our health. And reaching out his hand, this is interesting, he touched him. So not only was it against the law for that man to reach out and come to Jesus, for Jesus to reach out and touch him would make Jesus unclean. And so Jesus was doing something that would defile himself in the eyes of the public. And he touched him and he said, "I am willing. Be made clean." And immediately, the disease left him. It's interesting when I look at this encounter and I see this story, because this leper was a lot of, it was just a disease of isolation. It was isolation is what we see. The isolation may have been more, deadly and more difficult to deal with than the leprosy and the infection itself. And I think about what sin does to our life and how sin wants to take us further than we wanted to go and keep us longer than we wanted to stay and cost us more than we ever wanted to pay. It's an infection that happens to us internally. And so our sickness may not be physical. Our sickness today may be spiritual, but nevertheless, Jesus makes the difference in our sickness to our health. And he touched this man and he said, no, I am willing. 2 Corinthians 5:21 says that God made him who knew no sin to be sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God in him. Translation, Jesus took my place. Verse 14, it says this, "Then he ordered him to tell no one, but go and show yourself to the priest and offer what Moses prescribed for your cleansing as a testimony to them." I love this statement and I almost left it out, but I put it in because I felt like it was important, because I think we need to know this, that cleansing always comes with conditions. Our cleansing comes with conditions. A lot of times in the church today, we accept the grace of God and we make it real easy. I mean, that's what we want to do. Jesus didn't come to make it harder. He came to make it easy. Okay? But sometimes we just think that, you know, I can just pray a prayer and I can lift up my eyes or I can acknowledge it or not, and I can walk out and go back to my life as normal and nothing change, and that's salvation. Friend, that's not what salvation is. Salvation is saying yes to the gift of God and His salvation, or His gift of grace over your life, Him taking the penalty and punishment of your sin away. That is salvation. But that is salvation that leads to a change, that leads to something different in my life. And that's what Jesus is saying to this leprous man. He's saying, listen, don't go tell anybody, but I need you to go show yourself to the priest and do what is required by the law for you to do. And so when I see that, I thought, you know what? Cleansing always comes with conditions. It comes with a condition in our life that maybe this gift that is so precious and so valuable from God to us, it may lead me to offer something of myself back to Him, because Jesus is the one who makes the difference. And this is what happened. But the news about Him spread even more, and large crowds would come, gather together to hear Him and be healed of their sicknesses. That man didn't have to say anything. Everybody that was watching that day saw it, and the news began to spread. That's what happens when cleansing happens. That's what happens when life change occurs. The news spreads and people come from everywhere to see the product or the person who was transformed by the power of God. You don't have to know everything about this book and about this faith in order to speak about it. You just need to know what God did for you. You just need to know. I mean, this is as simple as it is. I'm just a nobody trying to tell everybody about somebody who can change anybody. I mean, that's as simple as it is. I can say this: I once was lost, but now I'm found. I was blind, but now I see. It's Jesus who makes the difference. He makes the difference between our failures and successes. He makes the difference between our sickness and our health. And this is what we learned today, that Jesus' power fuels the courage to call on Him. It took courage for this man to call on Jesus. He had to muster everything he had. He was breaking the law, but he was going to do it in order to be restored back to health. Today I want you to know that Jesus is the difference. He's the difference from your failures to your successes, from your sickness to your health, and finally, from your guilt to your forgiveness. This is a powerful story, and I love this. It says, one of those days, one of these days, following these encounters, while He was teaching, Pharisees and teachers of the law were sitting there. Now things are changing. Now the word is breaking out about this Jesus. And so it's not just the common people that are gathering. Now the church leaders are coming. And you know what? It was their responsibility to do that, because they were required to make sure that the new teachers and the prophets of those days were speaking the Word of God accurately. And so now they're here. They are gathered and they're listening to what Jesus is saying. And they had come from every village of Galilee and Judea, and also from Jerusalem. The big dogs are coming now. And the Lord's power, I love this, to heal was in Him. The Lord's power was in Him to heal that day. And just then some men came, four guys, carrying on a mat a man who was paralyzed. And they tried to bring him in and set him down before Him. But they could not find a way to bring him inside because of the crowd. The story breaks down like this. There's four guys, whatever their names are, Billy Bob, John, Cletus, and Rufus, whatever they are. And they got a buddy. and their friend is sick. And they've heard the stories about Jesus and the commotion that's in the village and that he's in town. And they think, listen, we got to get this guy. Our friend's paralyzed. He can't walk. This is our moment to get him to Jesus. And so those boys throw him on a cot and they get him to this house. But the crowd is so packed in the house and outside of the house that they can't get in. I mean, they're like, can we get in? They're like, where you want to go? You can't get inside. We're trying to get in. Nobody can get there. So they do what desperate friends do. They went up on the roof. They tore a hole in the roof and they lowered him on the mat through the roof tiles into the middle of the crowd before Jesus. I mean, I'm picturing this moment. I'm picturing whose house is this? I mean, can you imagine the homeowner? Some people believe that it was Simon Peter's house. And can you imagine Simon Peter? He's sitting there, man, everybody's listening. He's like, oh yeah, yes, amen, hallelujah. Stuff starts falling. He's like, oh no. I know my wife told me to fix that spot on that roof, but not now, Lord, not now. Don't let it fall right now. And it just keeps getting worse and worse. And the crowds try to push away, and all of a sudden you see daylight. And he's like, I mean, what would you do? I mean, what would you do on my roof? And you see these four guys looking in, and you see the roof hole get bigger and bigger because they got to let this guy through. And all of a sudden you see a cot being lowered down by ropes. And this guy laying on this cot, talk about doing whatever it takes. I want to know. I'm going to ask you this question. Who's your one? Who's that one person that you know? Who's that one person that you know, whether they're dealing with failure, sickness, or guilt, that you would do whatever it took to get that person to Jesus? Think about that person right now, because that's exactly what's going on here. And seeing their faith, Jesus said to the man, I love this, seeing their faith. Not just the man's faith, but his buddy's faith as well. Seeing the faith of all of these people, he said, friend, your sins are forgiven. Friend, your sins are forgiven you. Wait a second. Whoa. I'm not thinking about my sins right now. I'm thinking about my paralysis. I'm thinking about my problem and my struggle. I'm thinking about the issues. And sometimes my issues can blind me to the real problems that I have in my life. Then the scribes and the Pharisees began to think, not say out loud, think, who is this man who speaks blasphemies? Because no one can forgive sins but God alone. I love this. But perceiving their thoughts, Jesus replied to them, why are you thinking this in your hearts? He says, which is easier to say, your sins are forgiven you, or to say, get up and walk? Well, I mean, obviously my answer would be the first one would be easier to say, because who can prove whether or not that happened? The more difficult thing to say would be to get up and walk. And so Jesus said, but so you know that the Son of Man, which is a messianic title, and they recognize that, has the authority on earth to forgive sins. He told the paralyzed man, I tell you, get up, pick up your mat, and go home. Get up, pick up, and stand up. Get up, pick up, and go home. And so that's exactly what he did. Immediately he got up before them. He picked up what he had been lying on, and he went home and he spoke up, glorifying God. I mean, imagine that moment. Jesus said all of those things. Now, if I'm the guy laying on the mat, I could have been the guy that said, but I can get up. I'm like Peter, Lord, I've done this all night. God, I've done this all night and we've caught nothing. I've cleaned the nets. I mean, we're tired, we're hungry, we're ready to go home. But nevertheless, it's your word. And he did it. He could have been like the leper who did whatever he could to get to Jesus, and Jesus healed him and said, don't tell anyone, go show yourself to the priest. The priest don't want to see me. But he had been transformed and cleansed. And now here's this guy. He could have said, I can't. That's why I'm on this cot. I can't get up. No. This guy got up and obeyed. He got up in obedience. He didn't just get up. He took what was confining him. He took what was a symbol of his paralysis. He put that under his arm, what he had been lying on, and he went home. No longer would he have to go through the roof. Now there was a way parted for him to go out through the door. Then everyone was astounded. Because when you see and encounter stories like this, it doesn't just change your life, it changes people around you. And they were all giving glory to God, and they were filled with awe. And they said, "We have seen incredible things today." See, it's real simple. Jesus' power ignites the opportunity to obey Him. And so, simply put today, Jesus is the difference. Jesus is the difference from failure to success. Jesus is the difference from sickness to health. Jesus is the difference from guilt to forgiveness. I just want to know, what power are you going to follow? What power are you going to let control your life? Are you going to let something that appears to be an interruption keep you from an incredible invitation? You see, this is exactly what we said today. Jesus' power, it unleashes the faith to follow Him. Jesus' power fuels the courage to call on Him. And finally, Jesus' power ignites the opportunity to obey Him. Because it's very simple today. The takeaway is this: Jesus makes the difference. Listen, I don't know what you're going through today. I don't know if you can find yourself in one of these places or one of these stories. But I know this: a lot of life's greatest invitations simply look like, in the beginning, they're an interruption. Today is an invitation. It's not an interruption. It's an invitation to let your faith take hold of you and you follow Jesus. It's an invitation for you to have the courage to call on Him. It's an invitation just to simply ignite the power of Jesus in your life and give you an opportunity to obey Him. Because Jesus is the difference. I'd like for you to just take a moment, bow your head and close your eyes. As you sit in this room today, I want you to just simply ask yourself this question: is Jesus the difference in my life? Your situation may not be failure to success. It may not be sickness to health. It may not be guilt to forgiveness. It may be something else. The power today is not found in the words. The power today is found in the one in the middle. And Jesus is always the one in the middle, because He's the difference. And if you don't know Him today, I want to simply begin by inviting you an invitation to join us in this journey with Him. The Bible simply says, believe in your heart that God raised Jesus from the dead, and confess Him, Jesus is Lord, with your mouth, and you'll be saved. Simply check out this prayer, pray this with me, but whatever you do, believe it in your heart and confess Him with your mouth. Say, "Father God, I believe in You. I believe You sent Your Son to be my Savior. Jesus, I repent for my sin. Jesus, forgive me for my sin by Your grace and restore me to You. Jesus, be the Savior and Lord of my life. Help me follow You, because I say yes to You today, Jesus." Amen. Amen. Hey, if you said yes today, if you prayed that with me, I'm so excited for you. And I want to invite you, we would love to connect with you. And this is the easiest way I know to do that. If you're watching from Facebook, you can simply type the name Jesus in the comment feed. And that lets us know that you said yes today. Or if you're watching from a device, YouTube or anything like that, you can text the name Jesus to the number below. And that lets us know so that we can send resources to you and help you begin growing in this journey, this faith journey with Jesus. It's the journey of a lifetime, and it's one that you'll never forget. And I want to thank you for joining us today. Invite you to join with us in mission. If you want, through giving a tithe or an offering, simply $5 makes a difference today. You can do that in your connection with us, and it makes a huge difference all over this globe. The second thing is this. Man, if you live in this area and somewhere in the North Georgia area, we invite you to come to one of our two locations at Redstone or Commerce and see what home looks like here at Southside. Thanks for joining us. God bless you. We hope you have a great week.
I knew I was lost. Death and darkness were my only songs. I needed someone to come rescue me. Then mercy heard my plea. Yeah.
Lord, you found me. You heal me. You call. Jesus, you wash my sins away. Well, now I'm living, I'm forgiven. You came and set me free.
Yeah.
That's what your mercy did for me.
You gave me beauty for my guilty stain. Can't contain.